I think I know most of you. So I'm going to be talking today about fear, which is a big problem in my life, and hopefully it can help many of you. And I guess it's a little ironic because I have a fear of public speaking, so I'm very nervous right now, but I'm going to try to shake off the jitters as I go. So first, I'll start with a little bit about me. So I'm a nerd. That's what this picture is supposed to imply. This is one reason I wanted to go WPI, because I'd heard it was a nerd school when I was maybe, I don't know. I like that. But I'm a very specific kind of nerd. So I've never seen a Star Wars movie. So yeah, I feel like I can't call myself a movie nerd just for that reason. So I'm also not a gaming nerd. I've never played Halo, World of Warcraft, or Overwatch for that matter. I'm also not a tabletop gaming nerd, because I'm not a big fan of Settlers of Catan, but that's okay. I like Splendor and Dominion. I've never seen Bleach. So for those of you that don't know, Bleach is one of the most famous animes, and I've never seen it, and I'm not intending to, so I can't be an anime nerd either. So these are all things I'm not. So what kind of nerd am I? Maybe you guys can already guess. I'm a math nerd. So yeah, and there are math people, math corner over there, it's great, yeah. So I couldn't resist, even though this has nothing to do with the rest of my talk, I couldn't resist sharing some weird thing that I found recently. It's a little smaller on the screen, but can you read that? It's like one half is less than mod of y over 17 and some stuff. So this looks really weird, but what is it? This is actually a graph, a formula that graphs itself, which I think is the coolest thing ever. If you take a point, right, in this range, and you check the xy coordinates if it satisfies it, so if that whole thing is greater than 1/2, you plot it. If it's less than or equal to 1/2, you leave it blank. Then you get this picture. Which is itself. So I think this is really awesome. And I guess there are two things I should mention about it. It's not quite perfect, because there's something a little bit wrong with this the axes. So it's actually flipped backwards and upside down. So it actually goes from 106 to 0, and it goes from k to k plus 17. And k is also like why do I have this k? Why is it not like, I don't know, 0 to 17? So it turns out you have to go very high in the graph in order to get this. The rest of it, I think, is nonsense below that. So k is kind of big. It's that big. So it's according to Wikipedia, 543-digit number. So it's, yeah. But I still like, I don't know, I thought this is really cool. This has nothing to do with anything. But anyway, yeah, this is just some trivia. So yeah, have any of the math people heard of this before? No, this is in a really cool book called Things to Make and Do in the Fourth Dimension. It's great. But yeah, so the main thing I'm talking about is fear. So this is the other side of, I guess, I really like math. And I'm also very cautious when it comes to math. And sometimes I have trouble distinguishing between when caution is good in an academic setting and when caution is bad and leads to fear in general in my life. So this says me in every class ever, but it's actually probably me in many situations. I'm generally very sort of a worrier. I worry a lot about lots of things. So one example is schoolwork. But I feel like many of us can relate to this sort of worst case scenario thinking. So this actually happened a few weeks ago. My master's math project presentation was not done, and it was due the next day, and I was really tired. I was run down, I was sick, or I was getting sick, and I just come out of a really hard 3-hour class, stochastic processes, as some people know, and so I had a headache. I didn't want to work on it. So I thought of two scenarios. So if I stay up and work on it, then I'll probably get sick, since I was already getting sick. So I would have needed like a 14-hour sleep at that point. But if I don't, then I reasoned through the process in fear. I said I will probably fail my master's project, which is not justified already, but this is my thought process. And then I had a job offer from MITRE, which I was really excited about. And I thought, if I fail that, I won't graduate. And then MITRE will retract their job offer, so it'll be terrible. And then I'll have to get a subpar job, because if I can't work at MITRE, I won't be able to work anywhere that I like, and I'll hate it, which is also not valid. And then I'll hate my life. And so either I get sick or I hate my life. So which one should I choose? Of course I'm going to choose getting sick. But actually, I was so worried when I went through this reasoning that I couldn't focus anyway. So I did the worst thing possible. I stayed up, but I didn't work on it. So I got sick and I started this line of reasoning. So this is what happens. So fear is supposed to protect us, I guess in general, but it actually has the worst effect possible. So I want to try to figure out, I'm going to try to share ways that I found to try to overcome fear. Before that, I'm going to share something, I guess, a little more personal. This is one of my worst experiences with fear. So this was an IQP, and this sounds severe, but I guess it's not as severe maybe as it seems. But I did have thoughts of suicide while I was on IQP. And it was nothing more than that. No attempts or even like planning or whatever. But I guess IQP to me was so open-ended that it was hard for me to know how I was doing. So and it was also very high stakes. I feel like it was the first time, and they were always telling us, all the advisors and stuff, I hated hearing this repeatedly. You know, remember, you're representing WPI in this country, because I went to Denmark with Joey, actually. He was my roommate, and great encouragement to me there. And while I was going through this. But it was, they would always tell us, you know, you're representing WPI, you know, the pressure's on, you have to make sure that you conduct yourself professionally. To me, I took that to a very high level, and I was very stressed. I thought, any time that I'm out on the streets in Denmark, you know, people are watching and judging WPI, which is also not valid. But this is kind of thought process that fear sometimes brings, I think. So this came to this incredible, extreme in this situation. But it actually had a positive effect. It was actually freeing because I realized I'm worried about like messing up, making WPI look bad, you know, getting a knack. Have any of you guys heard of NAC? This is something I found out about right before IQP, which also scared me. It's actually like a secret grade that you can only get on projects that is worse than NR. It's like a permanent thing on your record, stands for not acceptable. And I thought, great, if I get this, I'm like branded as like a, you know, a really bad student, like nobody will want to hire me, and it's permanent. So that kind of scared me. But the main point was, I saw all this stuff was a sign that my fear was out of control, because obviously, dying or being severely injured is much worse than getting a knack. So, or in the worst case, and end up going fine anyway. So a lot of this helped me realize that fear was a big problem in my life, and it was a lot of phantom fears. It was things that weren't going to come true, after all. So fear is not good for us. I'm going to share some ways that I found to overcome it. But first, I guess I have two verses for why fear is not good. So. We can motivate ourselves in other ways. But God always says, do not fear. I don't think he ever says fear, except when he says, fear the Lord, which is a different thing. So he says, like, and I think these verses are pretty familiar. So don't be anxious about anything, but in every situation, with thanksgiving, by prayer and petition, present your requests to God. And then he also says in Joshua, my favorite book, he says, have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous, and do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged, for God will be with you wherever you go. So I think these are encouraging, that we can overcome fear. God didn't want us to live in fear. So I learned recently, actually, three ways to conquer fear that I'm going to divide into past, present, and future, except in a different order. I'm going to start with being present. So the first way to conquer fear, I think, is that in the present moment, we can either focus on fear or we can focus on God. And choosing to focus on God, being present in each moment with God, is a way to conquer it. And I'm going to give an example. This is sort of my running example. It's from a chess tournament that I went to about a month ago. And I had a chance to put these things into practice at this chess tournament. So a little bit about the chess tournament, I guess, first. So this was a weekend chess tournament. So it was five rounds, three on the 7th and two on the 8th. And this was also high stakes for me. This is probably the second most thing that I felt was high stakes. Like IQP was probably the highest stakes. MQP wasn't for some reason, I don't know why. But then the chess tournament was the second thing. And the reason was that I was in money trouble in this month. Like I thought I could get through my master's year without a stipend and without student loans, which was a very bad idea. Don't do that. You know, so my student loans just came in last month, so now I'm fine. But it was this was the month right before that. I'd already applied and I was waiting. And I had no money to pay rent. I'd already borrowed money from lots of different people, and it was sort of awkward. So I thought, I should enter this tournament because maybe I have a chance at winning. And the prizes were really nice. I think this is actually an underestimate. I think they promised 900 for first place, but I wrote what the actual prizes were. And 600 for second. Yeah, it was based on entries, and I guess fewer people entered than could, or than they were expecting. So I thought, even if I get second place at 600, that will be enough. I needed around 600 to pay rent and utilities at that point. And the entry fee is 89, and that counts as part of it. So it would be net 500. And I borrowed from my parents, who were very nice because they were in some troubles too financially, but they had faith in me that I could win. And I thought that's really nice. I didn't have to convince them at all. They actually suggested it. Like my dad said, hey, there's this chess tournament, you should enter it. And I thought, I don't think so. I think it's too much of a risk. I hadn't played in 10 years other than online, and it was very different style games. But he said I should, so that was really encouraging. So I did, and I learned all these things, and mostly in the second day. So this was my fourth round opponent. So this was Sunday morning. I had won my first three games, so I was doing well. But fear was starting to set in, because it was sort of the crucial time. These are the players that have also won all their games. He'd also won all his games. And he's 11 years old, so I feel like underestimating him, but I shouldn't. He's very good. And his rating 1650, which was higher than mine at the time. So I was feeling kind of brittle as I went into the situation, which is not good, but that's sort of like, out of fear, I essentially made two big mistakes at the beginning of the game. So one was that I didn't ask if I could eat food. So I went without food for 5 hours, which was, I was afraid that if I asked the TD, the tournament director, if I could eat food, in the middle of the game, he would say, I'm talking to him in the middle of the game or something, and that's not allowed, and I'd be disqualified. That's another phantom fear. And then I also had another phantom fear about winning easily earlier in the game. I could have won easily, but I thought I was missing something. So I thought, instead of playing a forcing move, I'll play a safe move and let the game continue. So this is what happened. So I actually do have chess positions in this talk. I know probably most of you aren't chess players, so I'll explain also. But so we end up in this situation. So I just, is there a laser pointer on this?
Yeah, the top button.
Top button. Yeah, maybe not. Yeah, I'll just point to it. So, is that going to be fine? Yeah, I think it's fine. So this was my move. I was white. I just played my queen here. So any chess players, do you know what black can do at this point? You can raise your hand, actually, make it a little interactive. Yeah.
You can take your bishop. No, he can't.
Yeah, he can't take the bishop, actually, thankfully.
He can't take the queen or the rook.
So he can't take the queen either, but he can do this. He can pin the queen. And this is really bad. This is terrible. This is the worst possible thing. This is the kind of blunder I was trying to avoid by being overly cautious. So this is like a huge panic moment right now, because I was winning the entire game. My pawns are really nice here because they're kind of, I have more space, and his king is in a weird spot. So I have this advantage, and so for non-chess players, the queen is the most important piece in the game. It can move in any direction, and I'm about to lose it for a bishop, which is really not very good. It can only move diagonally. So this is really bad. This essentially means that I would lose if there's not a way out. But that's the point. There is a way out, and this is what's really cool. So I guess first I'll mention, so God always gives us a way out. This is what I mean by being present in the moment with God. If you choose to focus on God, you look for the way out that he's giving you from any situation, then you can, it's like an antidote to panic almost. So here's a verse. This is related to temptation, but I was tempted to give up at this point. So I can see that there's a link. So no temptation has overtaken you except what's common to man, or mankind. God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you're tempted, he will provide a way out so that you can endure it. So in this case, I was tempted to give up, but he provided a way out for me not to give up. But we have to be on the lookout for it. That's the point. So what I mean by my first point, overcoming fear, being present in a moment with God, is to not focus on your panic, to focus instead on the way out that God guarantees us. And it won't always be like a winning move in a chess game. Maybe I was losing this point. But then my way out would have been to not freak out about it. It would have been to learn something from that. But in this case, it's actually really cool. I had a saving move. So this one's really hard to see, I think. Maybe. But what I did was this. I move my bishop and take this pawn. And this actually saves me. And I feel like I don't want to lose everybody, because I feel like, how many people are chess players actually? Oh wow. Okay. Well, it's WPI. I guess that's cool. So that's awesome. So okay. So essentially, so for non-chess players, this saves my queen, or it gets his queen in exchange for my queen, which is a fair trade. But so, and for chess players, I'll explain. So the rook takes a bishop, then this bishop's undefended, so I can take it, and then I'm saved. So if he doesn't take the bishop, he's got to move the king, and then I can take his queen. Now what I actually did was he moved the king back, I took this bishop first, then he takes, and then I take the queen. That way I don't, that's actually the safe way to do it, so that I don't lose an extra bishop. So in that case, we end up being just a rook and a bishop left after all the chaos. And then there was this cool picture at the end where everybody was watching, because this was the last game and it was like, we both had like a minute left in the clock at this point. And this is the last rook and bishop, it's hard to see, but they're the last ones here. So the game ended up being a tie, or a draw. Because God gave me a way out and I was on the lookout for it and I found it. And so, I don't know, I think that can be encouraging, because it's a principle that you can apply to counter fear. And it worked out nicely in this case. So that's one. So then there's also the future element of fear. I think fear of the future, we could call it anxiety, but it's which is another thing that I struggle with. And trusting God for the future is how you can handle that. So the point of trust, I guess, trust is not making somebody prove everything to you in advance so that you know already that's guaranteed to work out. That's the opposite of trust. Trust is when you don't know if it's going to work out. You don't know what's going on. God does something weird, and you wonder about it, but you still trust him. So assume the best of God, even if we don't know what's going on. And this is a verse that is also familiar, I think, that we know in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who've been called according to his purpose. So all things work together for good. So God is arranging things for our good, even if it doesn't look like it at the time. And this is a very common theme, but this was something I got to experience firsthand, and then it didn't feel so trite to me, because it was in this intense game against this guy. So this guy was even younger, 10 years old. So this would be even more embarrassing to lose to him or draw with him. And his rating was lower, but he ended up putting more of a fight than the fourth round. So this was actually an even harder game than the fourth round. And I was thrown off from my draw, so this was kind of scary. And we just repeated moves once. So we moved queens back and forth. He didn't do it directly. He did some other things in between, but you can see like queen e2, c2, e2, same square. And me, I did actually c8, f5, c8, f5. So we're moving back and forth a while. And I think I'm losing in this situation, but I think it's still unclear. So I thought, well, this has been a really tough tournament. I had thought at first God wanted me to win, because he'd given me a sense a few moves earlier, actually, around move 40. He gave me a sense, inexplicably, I mean, this sounds a little weird, I guess, but he gave me a sense that I would win at exactly move 56. And spoilers, that ended up happening. So that was really cool. But at this time, I was starting to not be sure. And I thought, okay, well, I'll trust God anyway. Maybe this is a weird thing that I just thought that was wrong. Maybe it's something that, you know, I should learn not to trust feelings or something. So I was a little confused. So I thought, okay, well, I really feel like offering a draw. So I'll offer him a draw. And my reasoning was actually very interesting. It was related to certain circumstances in the other games. So I would have had 4 out of 5 points if he accepted the draw offer. And this is where I want to explain a little bit. Is this visible?
Yep.
You think? Okay. So, like, yeah, I think this is enough space. So there were 4 boards. So there was me and my opponent. And I had 3, what did I have? I had 3.5 points at this time, I think. Yeah. I had 3.5 points. My opponent had 3 points. Then the fourth round guy also had 3.5 points because it was a draw. And his opponent had 3 points. So this was me thinking about how much money would I win if I got a draw. That's what this reasoning is based on. So then there were 2 other people. There was, it was Seamus over here and his op. And then is Manav here and his opponent. And I think these guys each had 3, and this guy had 2.5, and this guy had 3. So these were the standings. And actually, this guy had already won. So he had won. So he already had 4.5, and that was the end. And this guy just had 3, and it was very frustrating. They were right next to me. So my fourth round opponent beat this guy in like an hour, and then he already had like as perfect a score as anybody could get at that point, because I was the only other person with 3.5. So this is frustrating. So I felt like I have to win this game, and even in order to tie for first. So if I draw, then what will happen? So let's see. So if I draw, then I get, what do I want to say? I want to say at the end, I guess. At the end, I would have 4 points. And my opponent would have 3.5. No, he'd have 3.5. So a draw is half point. Then I was looking at the other games, and this is the interesting thing. So these games, they have to end in a certain way in order for the other people not to get 3.5 points. I want to be the only person with, or 4 points. I want to be the only person with 4 points. Then I can get second place and get $600. So I looked at the games while we were in this position. And this looked like it was going to be a draw. This looked like this guy was going to lose. And actually, when I think about it, yeah. Is that true? Let's see. Yeah. This was a situation. So it looked like this was going to be a draw. This guy was going to lose. So I thought, okay, that's perfect. Because that would mean that these guys each get 3.5. And then he gets 3 still, and he gets 3.5. So then nobody would have 4 except me. So I get clear second. So I thought, okay, this is actually an okay risk to take in this situation. So I took it. And yeah, so I get clear second, get about 600. And so that's what I did. I offered the draw, and then he declined. So I felt disappointed at this point. I felt like, what's going on? I first God told me that I would win at move 56. Then he didn't say anything, and I felt like I should offer a draw. And then I offer a draw, and it's declined. So actually, if given what happened, God was being honest the whole time. He said I would win at move 56, and then he said nothing. So it was my own doubts throughout the whole time. But he ended up using that. He ended up using my doubts to actually make everything work out. Because this move, declining the draw, was instrumental in my winning. And there's a thing in chess, actually, that in chess psychology that I've read about, that I think is a real thing, that when you offer a draw, you're kind of admitting that your position is worse. Like I'm saying, like, oh, please, like, accept my draw. I really want a draw because I think I'll lose. So that makes the opponent feel complacent. So he feels like, oh, wow, my opponent actually thinks I'm doing really well. So I don't have to worry too much. So he made this move, and I think it's a very lazy move. And the reason is that it leaves a lot of things sort of pinned, I guess. So one thing that will be important later is that this pawn is the only pawn that can take the knight. So if I take here, the queen's undefended. So if I take here and he takes there, then I'll take the queen for free. So that's one issue with this move. Another issue is it doesn't attack this pawn anymore. So if the queen was there instead, like it was moving back and forth, then I won't be able to maneuver my rook around, because at some point he'll be able to take the pawn, because my rook will leave the defense. So long story short, this move was instrumental in winning for a bunch of different reasons, and I found that out on move 56. So this is his 56th move, and this is a move where I immediately win. It's the move that that we see the effects of this queen f3. So now, chess players, what do you think I did? So there's a move that wins immediately. Oh, and did I specify in black? Oh. Yeah, I should specify that. Yeah. Yeah, that's what I do. I take the pawn with my rook. So why does this win? So the rook is defended. He can't take it. His queen has nowhere to go. If it goes somewhere else, then I can do this. And then I immediately, that's immediate checkmate. directly, because I'm supported by my rook. So this move that he did because I offered a draw, because of my doubt, ended up letting me win the game. I guess this. So is this not obviously winning? Maybe not. Maybe I'm assuming too much. Yeah, that's fine. I was wondering how chess heavy I wanted this talk to be. But okay. So this is one part. But then the really eerie part is next. So the eerie part is that the other games I thought would end up in the best way, I looked. These people had a very drawish game. This guy looked like he was going to lose. They actually ended up in the worst possible way. So what actually happened was, this guy won. So he got 4. And this guy also won. So he got 4. So I would have actually tied for 3rd and 2nd. And let's see, so I think it would only have been 3 other people, come to think of it. So there might be a typo here, 4 other people. But I know in my calculations, these games worked out in such a way that I would have walked home with $60 if he had accepted the draw. So that's even less than the entry fee. So it would have been a miserable experience for me. So, because of that, if I had known that, I would not have offered the draw. So this is the interesting thing. My suspicion is God orchestrated these games to appear a certain way so I'd feel comfortable taking the risk of offering the draw. And then he had them work out this way so that I could have this illustration, maybe. I don't know. Which I think this is really cool. So then I walked home with 650, which is amazing. I tied for first. So we split the first and second prize money. So it ended up being a little under 1,400, because there were fewer entrants. So that was an amazing experience. And I felt like that was an example of me trusting God for the future. Well, it was an example of me not trusting God for the future, but it working out anyway. But I think that can be encouraging too, because God does work things out, even if it doesn't seem like it will. And even if we doubt and do something that seems wrong in our doubts. So this is a really nice thing. He can work everything, including us not trusting him, into a good result. And then the third thing that I'll close with is remembering what God has done in the past. So this would have helped me to not be nervous in the tournament if I had remembered in the moment that God had gotten me through many other things, many miserable finals and homeworks and chess games in the past. And this is something that I want to emphasize. So I think this is actually the best way to counter fear of the three. This is why I did past at the end instead of past, present, future. Because I think it helps to remember how God's provided for us, even if we're worried. But this can be tough. So the reason it can be tough if we try to remember in the moment of our fear is that fear distorts our thinking, I think. I think if you try to remember something while you're really afraid or while you're really nervous, it somehow loses something, or you don't remember it quite right, or at least that happens to me. So I get confused and I get upset. And our memories can become clouded. We can even misremember things or view them in like a different colored glasses, kind of, depending how we're feeling. So I think a very important thing to do is to keep a record of something right when it happens, right when God has provided something for you. Keep a record while you're feeling clear. That's what I started actually after my IQP experience. I started a journal and it really helped me. So here's a verse from Habakkuk, actually, which is a book that is like you never hear a verse from this, but I found this. I thought this is kind of cool. So write my answer. So the Lord had given a prophecy that was going to come true much later, I think even beyond Habakkuk's life. So he said, write my answer plainly on tablets so a runner can carry the correct message to others. It's for a future time, describes the end, and it will be fulfilled. And he says that it won't be delayed. But the point here is that he wanted him to write it down. He didn't want him to just have a memory of it that would become clouded over time and by, you know, maybe also clouded by his unbelief at some point or his lack of faith if it took too long, you know. If it's on the tablets, it's going to be pristine. It's going to be just the way it was expressed the whole time. So this is my challenge to everybody, is to keep a journal, even if it's just, this is the next slide, that's what everybody should do. So right after the tournament, I wrote the whole experience in my journal, and this is essentially from that. And in my case, it's a huge text file, you know, from a stone tablet. So, and it's like somehow text file for me helped, because I tried journaling like in the past on and off with notebooks, like handwritten, and for some reason it never worked for me. But a text file, I feel like I can be blissfully disorganized. There's no pressure to like make it nice and neat because it's just text. So now it's up to like 100,000 lines of like random stuff, which is really cool. Like I like that. And I think it's helped me a lot. Like I've looked back on things from it. So try keeping a journal just for D-term and see what happens. Just, it doesn't have to always be God experiences. It can be just stuff that you think, you know, you came across that you find interesting, like my bizarre graph that was from my journal too, at the beginning that I showed. And you know, whenever you're feeling inspired or clear, I think it's especially good to write when you have clarity about something, even if you don't feel like it. Like you feel like actually doing something or, you know, getting work done or whatever. But sometimes it helps to take a moment of the precious clarity that you have to write it down so you can help yourself later. And you can look back on it later and remind yourself of two things, what God has done and what he's currently doing. So that's my recommendation. It's definitely helped me a lot. I think things have been a lot better for me since then, although, of course, I'm still working on it. So let's pray. So thank you, God, for this time. Thank you for calming my nerves. I didn't think I could possibly be this comfortable after a few minutes, so thank you for that. Thank you for all that you do for us. Thank you for being with us in each moment, for giving us a way out. Please encourage us and help us to be able to find that way out that you provide for us, to be on the lookout for it. And I thank you for being trustworthy and always coming through for us, Lord, and even working out our mistakes for good. And I pray you just bless everyone here as we go back to whatever we're doing for the break. And just thank you for all these things. In your name we pray. Amen.